The following interview was sponsored by the Greek American Heritage Society of Philadelphia, preserving and perpetuating our community's history.
I'll say First Lieutenant Graham Charles Gould was a pilot. Second Lieutenant Yale Lasker was a co-pilot. First Lieutenant Thomas W. Lee, Jr. was a navigator, and First Lieutenant Ralph J. Reynolds was a bombardier. Tech Sergeant Leonard Mock was the flight engineer. Staff Sergeant Tony Gloria was the tail gunner. Peter C. Bandy, waist gunner. Staff Sergeant Valley Thompson, ball gunner. And Tech Sergeant August C. Anderson was a radio operator. These people were we were really connected to each other because everyone knew that each one was going to take care of their position and take care of each one of us. You know, we were just linked together. I mean, we had confidence in who the pilot was and who the navigator was and what the bombardier was going to do. And the gunners were, you know, on the job. I mean, not laying off and just daydreaming. I mean, we watched out for fighters. I mean, I remember, you know, hours and hours of just staring out of the window, just watching who's going to intercept us. Yeah. But however, you know, when you got to the target, you didn't have to know. You knew you were where you were.
We're talking with Peter C. Bandy, a native son of Philadelphia, drafted in 1943 into World War II. He was a waist gunner on the 303rd Bomb Group in the 8th Air Force. Mr. Bandy served aboard the famed Thunderbird, which was a B-17 plane, which today a mural at the Smithsonian Museum now is part of the background when you go into the museum. Mr. Bandy, welcome to Cosmos Philly. Let's talk a little bit about growing up in Philadelphia. You were born in West Philadelphia, went to Overbrook High School.
Yeah, I graduated from Overbrook High School, and
you worked in a very famous candy store also.
Well, in my younger days, I worked in my father's store, which
what was it called?
Was the Philadelphia Sugar Bowl. It was a famous spot in Philadelphia, a popular spot. It was down at 8th and Race. So I was born on Vine Street, I guess, 59th and Vine. And then we moved to 59th and Jefferson, which is about 10 or 20 blocks above from that area. There were many Greeks in that area at that time, about three or four families, which is a lot to be in one area.
Which church did you go to?
Well, we frequent both churches, Evangelist Moss at 12th and Fitzwater, and St. George at 8th and Locust. In my earlier years, we went to 12th and Fitzwater, and that was in the 40s. About a couple of years later, we finally moved down to St. George, just because it was near to the store which my father had on 8th and Race.
And talk about that store a little bit. What did you do in the store?
At the store, we waited on customers. It was an ice cream parlor and a candy store. My father manufactured candy, so we had a big candy business. But we also had a big ice cream business too. We sold the Sundays at unforgivable prices, 10 cents the Sunday and 25 cents for a banana split. Unheard of, unheard of. I mean, they really got their money's worth then.
Do you remember Greektown at all?
Locust Street, yeah. There was a big group of Greeks that lived in Locust Street.
Did you mingle and mix it up in there?
We didn't, no, because we lived out in West Philadelphia.
And that was a big stretch.
So that was a big, you know, we were quite removed. It was an interesting time. Then my brother decided he was going to be going to theological school.
I'll mention his name because I don't know if everybody's
got. Brother Anastasius entered a theological school, I guess in 1939, I guess it was. I just not that exact. And of course, we didn't see him until after the war, you know, because by 1943, I was already in the European theater and I lost track of.
You're jumping the gun a little bit. Okay, so you lost track of your brother. But let's talk about you were drafted in 1943. And tell us who you were drafted and where you did your basic training.
Well, I was drafted in 1943 at March, a month after my birthday, because my birthday was in February. So a month later, I got that draft notice, and they sent us off to Indian Town Gap. And at Indian Town Gap, we were given physicals and filled into what we had to do. And they gave us many tests. They tested everyone for their ability, what they know how. And that's how I got into, I guess, to go to the Air Force, was I didn't select it. I was just put in that group. And that's how I got to go to Miami Beach.
Well, tell me about, I guess, someone in the military, when you got drafted and you went out to Las Vegas, yeah. Before Las Vegas,
yeah,
wasn't.
Well, our training, you see what our training was we went to school in Denver, the munitions school, where we learned about how the gun operates and how the bomb bay racks work and stuff like that, because that's the stuff that we were going to be dealing with when we get in the war theater. So, and then when we got to Las Vegas, we got the feeling of what it is to fly in an airplane, and that was one thing. And then when we were allowed a three-day pass to Las Vegas, we were restricted to where we went, because and they told us where to not to go, and it was just like a hick town. I mean, it's not the Las Vegas that you see here today. It's quite removed. You would never think of it that it would be the way it is. I mean, I went back in 1955, and I could see it. I said, "Jesus, what had happened here?" And it constantly grew, and it's now even bigger. And my last visit to Las Vegas was in the year of 2000, which was, I didn't enjoy Las Vegas at all. It was just one big, I don't know, it's gotten too overpopulated and too much everything.
Let's talk about your arrival in England. Let's jump forward there. You're being transferred now to be in what you call the European theater.
We're in the European theater, and we're going to our bomb group, which, you know, we didn't know which bomb group we'd be assigned to. Fortunately for me, it was the 303rd.
Do you know the date or the approximate time that you arrived?
Sometime after June the 7th. They took us when we landed in Scotland. We went to the British thing for lunch. But that wasn't our places to stay. And then they moved us off to a place called The Wash in England. And I had no clue what The Wash was for, but the whole crew went there. I learned after the war that The Wash was a pivoting point for location, for pilots or planes that lose their position. They don't know where they are. You can take a heading from The Wash, and that's why we went there. So the pilot could be would know it, the navigator would know it, the crew would know it. There was crews that got lost out just on a practice mission out over the North Sea and never returned.
Let's talk about the missions now. Let's get an idea, because you mentioned that we know that you served 35 missions, and you said that most crews never survived more than five to seven missions. Right, yeah. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Before we got into the plane, we'd pick up our parachute. We pick up our Mae West for in case you were shot down over water. We pick up our parachute.
What's a Mae West?
Mae West is a jacket that you wear so that you don't sink in the water. Okay. So you can survive, you know. So that, and we picked up a survival kit that they handed out to every bomb crew. And in that survival kit, the survival kit had a corned beef sandwich, maps, and it had a foreign currency, French currency, Dutch currency, I don't know what you call it, a morphine injection thing that in case you were injured and the pain was too great for you, you give yourself a shot of morphine to survive, you know. It just depends on what your injury is. So that was our survival kit. However, on a mission, the corned beef sandwich froze because we're at high altitude. It was 50 below up in the cabinet. We had electrical heated suits that kept us warm, gloves and slippers. But I never wore the shoe part of the electrical system because I didn't want to be without shoes if I got shot down, because you can't be walking too far with a piece of cotton things there. You wouldn't survive 1 minute. You wouldn't be able to walk nowhere. So I wore my shoes with about three pairs of stockings in them to keep my feet warm, because that's the only thing that bothered me during the mission was my feet. Most of our missions were done in Germany. But I do have a few missions in France. I went on one mission at St. Lô. It was around July the 24th or something, 44, at 10,000, altitude of 10,000 feet, which isn't very high. You can see the ground. And so, and we dropped just to make a hole, just to bury them, get rid of the Germans out of that fortress that they had, because they couldn't pass it, which we were successful in doing. There was two missions at St. Lô. I was on one of them.
What was your scariest mission?
All the missions are the scariest, but the worst missions were the big cities, because Munich is the fourth largest city in Germany. Berlin is the worst target to go to, because it was well protected, a lot of fighters, a lot of anti-aircraft. There are over 2,500 guns at these targets. They're endless. You think, wonder, will they ever quit? Don't they ever give up when you're flying? But you know, a mission, going past a mission, you may go by it in 10 minutes. You know, you fly by it in about 10 minutes. But when to go through that firing pass, the sky is unmerciful. Everything is exploding around you. You know. I don't know how they missed us. I really don't know how they missed us, but like I say, it's only a 10-minute swap. Right. You know, if you can live that 10 minutes, you're fine.
Your plane, I don't know which particular mission was hit.
Yeah.
And something historic that today most people have heard the name, but yeah, right. I'd like you to tell that story about that.
Our group was attacked by the fighters, our particular group, and I could see from my waist position, I see this ME-109. I can even see the pilot over there. And I said, this guy's shooting at us, because there's a flash going out there. He was shooting us, and he caught our stabilizer. When he caught our stabilizer, tore a big hole in that. But he also caught our... We took a shell in our gas tank, but it did not explode. I didn't know that until after the war. But the co-pilot showed me the thing. He says, I wear it, I have it on my office over there. This, you see this 20 millimeter cannon thing? It was a dud. It didn't explode. I'm lucky for that. However, when we were hit and we couldn't keep up with the formation, we see our formation flying away, and here we are fighting the just to keep afloat, you know, with a hole in the stabilizer. We two fighters from the Tuskegee Air Force. One was above us and one was below us, and on the intercom system, we were communicating with him. And
the
pilot from the fighter aircraft was saying to us, "I'm sitting right up here on top of you," and I recognized by his voice, he was a colored man. I said, "One was above us and one was below us. They were the Tuskegee Airborne Air Force, and they were instrumental in getting us back into friendly territory." That we could get back home to base. So I remember them clearly. I recognize from their voice. My safety depended a lot on where our position was in the formation. Fortunately, evidently our group always flew this position. Anytime we would form in the ready for combat, our position was tail end, Charlie in the low, which meant we were the low group, and we were the back side of it, which gave us more evasive action when we're in flight. In other words, when we're over a target, most of us stay close in formation, so you don't get too much chance to maneuver left and right too much because you're going to run into another bomber. But where our position was, tail end Charlie in the low, we had the position we could guide away. So we see too much anti-aircraft coming up that way. Well, we'll just get out of its firing power. I think that has a lot to our, I believe in my 35 missions that we made. We were able to get by safely. It was the position we flew in. It may not mean nothing to nobody else, but when I look at it now, the position had a lot to do with where you are, because if you're in the middle position, you're not gonna, you can't move too much. You run another bomber. And you know, bombers used to drop bombs. We see them go down, you know, where we're flying, tail end Charlie low. We see bombs coming down. So when they didn't hit us, I don't know. I just wondered, it's unexplainable to me.
35 missions later, it was time to go home. Tell us about your return to the States.
My return to the States was another really interesting thing, because when I left England on November of 44, the war was not over. But at the base, they had said, we're not getting any more replacements, parts for the planes, that the war will be over by Christmas, and they thought that they had everything tied up, but it did not turn that way, because the Battle of the Bulge came along and held them up a bit. And I participated in one of those, the raid before we left, that was back in October of 44. We went to we're at the Battle of Bulge, Eindhoven. We went to a town in Holland called Eindhoven, and at Eindhoven is where they were getting reinforcements. We had the 101st Airborne Division flying with us with our coverage. They used the bomber as a coverage because these transports didn't have any guns on them. They were just transporting troops. And those paratroopers were jumping out at Eindhoven over there. The sky was, I never saw so many airborne men jumping out. You know, I said, these guys crazy over there. I had no clue what was going on. But they were fortifying they knew the Battle of the Bulge, Germans were going to do something in that area. So they sent them reinforcements. But I was instrumental in dropping bombs at Eindhoven. I think they call that Market Garden, that phase. When we left England, we came back by boat, so they moved us to Liverpool. Liverpool is where we picked up a boat. The Army renamed it the USS West Point, but it's a sister ship to the United States line. The United States line that has a ship on the Delaware Bay there in Philadelphia. It's parked there. It's been parked there for 8 years, and I don't know whatever happened to it, but that's the sister ship that I came back on. Anyway, we were three days out of Liverpool, and we ran into a northeast storm, one of these northeasters that were coming up the Atlantic, and the swells were as high as 40 feet high, the things. And I'm standing in that boat and saying to myself, I will survive 35 missions over Germany and live, and I'm going to drown here in the Atlantic Ocean over here. Because you could see the propeller come out of the water, you know, the ship goes up and it goes down, and holy smokes. I says, well, how do we ever get back? It was one day, and we got past that storm, or storm past that, either way. And we landed at Newport News for repair. That boat was going to go into repairs. That's why we only had a half a crew on it. They brought back prisoners of war, medical cases that was over there, and bomb crews returning to the United States. My radio operator was on that boat, and I didn't even know it.
Talk about your wife, where you met her, and what the situation was. That was sort of a U.S., was it a U.S.?
Well, we went to church in Salt Lake City, and when we went there, there was about five of us Greek boys were over there. And at Salt Lake City, they were given a dance, war relief, the Greek war relief. The church was given a dance of that, and so the Greek guys that we were there, well, should we go to that thing there, that the war relief? I said, yeah, we'll go to the war relief. So we went, when we went there, that's where I met my wife. And he also, the other Greek guy that I was with was from Connecticut, and he also met his wife from there too. And we both married the girls that we met. You know, I got married 2 days before the war ended. Uh-huh. That was something else. Because August the 12th of 44, the war ended. Japanese surrendered. I changed the whole posture in the United States here, but people didn't know it. It did, you know, for the military. Then they wanted to get us out, you know, because all of us guys that were back from the war zone, there was no jobs for us to do, even in the military. They had us policing, cleaning up the field, picking up butts and stuff like that. They either keep us or send us home. We don't, you know, we're going to stay over here. That's what it was during that intermission.
What did World War II teach you?
I knew all the suffering that the people have to go through and all the hardships that people have no clue over here what they would do in the case of an attack. Just ask yourself, what would you do if all of a sudden some goddamn big explosion come over there? You can't have no water, your water be shut off, your gas be shut off, your electric be shut off, you couldn't even cook your dinner. Or where you go to the toilet? I often wonder now what all those people do in Gaza and stuff like that. There's not a safe place you can go. They dehumanize you. You're not a human anymore. You have to live like a scavenger.
The war changed you, though, didn't it?
Well, I know what suffering is, what people have to go through, that they don't have all the convenience that you normally have, that you expect to have it. I mean, you expect to turn your light switch on to work. You turn your gas on.
Tell me about your family name, Bandy.
As far as what I can recall or whatever was told me, the name, we changed it to Bandy, but it was Bendy. I guess you would write B-E-N-D-I.
Well, tell us, your family came from where exactly?
From Berat, Albania. Uh-huh. and they came in the 1900s, you know, 1914 or 15 or 12 or somewhere in the 1900s. So they don't know too much about their, or they never told us too much about it because there was nothing to tell about. I mean, in the 1900s, come on, they got to be pretty backwards. They weren't, you know, forward like here. So I guess they were glad to come here.
Tell us about, did you receive any special recognition from the war or medals?
Well, during my tour of duty there, I have the Air Medal with four oak leaf clusters, the Distinguished Flying Cross, which is given, you know, on special occasions. They're the biggest entries I have. And then I get then you have that European African Middle East ribbon, whatever that means, I don't know. But I was in that area, you know, I was in the European theater.
Is there a lesson for today's generation or a thought you'd like to pass on?
I think that our generations today are too much involved in the new electronic methods of how they operate, and they've lost what's happened before. That's going to be forget. They're going to forget all these things that in the past. They're all with this new stuff, and I don't know if it's for good or bad. I don't know. I don't think it's going to be too good in the long run. Of course, people are you're controlled. All your movements are controlled. All your banking is controlled. Anything you got down do, you. I think pretty soon they're going to charge you for breathing air.
But life was different then, too. You know, there was a greater sense of freedom. Mm-hmm. When you went out west, there was a different sense of everything. Can you talk about that a little bit? What was that like for you when you traveled out to the Midwest and the West Coast?
Well, the West Coast, people were more friendly there. Their interest in everybody and families and stuff like that, where back east here, everybody's only interested in themselves. And the same thing out west was the same way. That's why I didn't stay out there at all. I moved out west, you know, for about a year and a half. And I couldn't hack it out there. I had to come back home. The only thing that was good out west was the weather. That you can't take away from them. I mean, no matter how bad of everything is, they have good weather. And I think I've done the right thing, because I'm happy in my old age. Now, I'm happy the fact that I do have good health, exceptionally good health for a person 90 years old, you know, and a good memory. A fairly good memory. I mean, it's not expert, but it's, you know, I get tangled up once in a while when I get interrupted or something in my trend of thought, and I just forget everything. But other than that, I'm happy with that. I mean,
how do you spend your day?
I spend my day odds and ends of just to keep me busy. I know I have to keep busy. A person who's old must keep busy. You must walk. You might not think walking don't help, but walking helps a lot. I walk. I do 3 miles a day when the weather is good and stuff like that. When bad weather, I don't go out. I'm not foolish. You can't be foolish, too. You just think, well, I'll go today. I don't go. Unless it's safe for me, I go. If it don't, I don't go. I don't take my walk. But I do walk. I walk a lot of steps here. I got a lot of things I forget, and I got to go up and down, back and forth, and that's what keeps me busy. You have to have that. You have to have a purpose to live. The other thing is you have to have a purpose to live. Fortunately for me, I have four children, and they're all successful, which is a plus, because when your children are in good shape, you're in good shape, because you don't have to take care of them, because you're going to eventually take care of them, because if any one of your children are something that they need attention and stuff like that, who's they going to help? They're going to come to their parents. They're going to help them.
Peter Bandy, we want to thank you again for speaking with us today, and thank you for your service to our country.
I'm glad I was able to do it, and I'm glad I survived. And I'd like to pass this information on to people who don't know how it is to be in a war zone. You have no clue. I just hope that when you wake up one of these mornings, you don't find yourself in that position, and you'll remember me and say, that guy was right what he said.
Thank you again.